Dear brethren and friends, we welcome you to the closing service in the last sermon in this series of sermons we presented at our annual spiritual conference in 2020. This conference has been dedicated to the great theme of the great biblical prophet, Prophet Elijah. In the previous three sermons, our speakers have shed light on the historic prophet Elijah, his ministry, the challenges he faced, the trials he endured, and the victories he won. We also looked at another great prophet, Prophet John the Baptist, who was coming in the spirit and power of Elijah and prepared the way for the first coming of Jesus Christ. And then we looked at another Elijah, Elijah who will appear in the last days of Earth's history and who will prepare the way for the second coming of Lord Jesus Christ in the clouds of heaven. Today, Brother Paul Chapman, the minister of gospel in Australia, a servant of Christ who has held various responsible offices in our church in Australia and also in our general conference, will address the topic, "What doest thou here, Elijah?" This topic surveys the parallels between historic Elijah, John the Baptist, and God's remnant people who live just before the second coming of Christ. We will see, we will focus actually on the faith relationship of these great prophets in the past and how the people of God can learn from their experiences. They climbed, both prophets climbed the high peaks and descended to depressing valleys, and in the experience of both men, the faith ultimately triumphed over uncertainty and distress. So, how the question, "What doest thou here, Elijah?" can help God's people refocus and recharge and lead them to the ultimate victory in the last great conflict. To that question, Brother Paul Chapman will give us answer in this sermon. Our gracious and loving Father in heaven, we are in your holy presence to thank you for graciously granting us the opportunity to have another wonderful, spiritually charged, and uplifting conference. We thank you, Father, for the messages we have heard that direct our thoughts to you, to your love, your justice, your mercy, your patience with us, Lord. We thank you for the opportunity to reflect on the great men of faith who have known you, who have served you, who were challenged, who experienced trials and distresses, but who persevered, holding your hand by faith. And Father, now we pray that as we enter into this closing service, that your spirit and your power may be with the speaker and especially with the listeners, that they may receive thy word in their hearts, that we all may understand the great lessons from the life and ministry of Prophet Elijah and the antitypical Elijah who you have designated to complete the great work of salvation. O Lord, help us to understand the times in which we live and the great work that you have entrusted to us. O Lord, help us to feel our dependence. Empower us with thy Holy Spirit. Put the words in our mouth and give us thy grace. We pray that you may bless all the viewers, all the brethren assembled in the meetings, that you may bless those who are sick among us, those who are discouraged, those who are in the valley of decision. O Lord, bless them richly and help them in their needs. Bless our churches, our conference. Bless the workers, the leaders. And help us, Lord, to move forward with hope and faith, looking upon the author and finisher of our faith, Jesus Christ, who for the joy that was set before him, he endured suffering and shame and even death. But he was resurrected and he is our Lord and he will come again in glory. O Lord, help us to prepare the way for him. Bless us, Lord, forgive us our sins and shortcomings, and bless all the brethren who have so generously participated in preparation of this conference. We ask all these things, and we thank you, Father, in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Good morning and welcome to the fourth in the series this weekend, Are You Elijah? Now, in this hour's message, I want to look at some parallels between the historic prophet Elijah, John the Baptist, and the remnant people of God in these last days. What can we as the last generation learn from the struggles and victories of these two great prophets? And how can we learn from the question, what doest thou here, Elijah? How can we take to heart that question and use it to refocus our energies and inspire us to greater victories in Christ and to our ultimate victory as we prepare for the second coming of Jesus and the great trials ahead of us? Well, to find out, let's take a look firstly at Elijah. I want to first look at Elijah's crisis, the crisis of his life. It was a crisis of faith. Let's have a look here. Elijah had just slain all the prophets of Baal at the command of God. Jezebel, the idolatrous queen and wife of Ahab, was furious. And we read here in 1 Kings chapter 19 and verse 2, "And then Jezebel sent a messenger unto Elijah, saying, So let the gods do to me and more also, if I make not thy life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time." Of course, she's referring here to the prophets of Baal that Elijah had just destroyed, had just killed, or slain. So she says, your life is going to be like those by tomorrow. Now, I don't know why, but Elijah's faith here wavered and his courage shrank. He fled for his life. Eventually, he came to Beersheba, and from there, he went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a juniper tree, and he requested for himself that he might die. And he said in 1 Kings 19, verse 4, "It is enough now, O Lord, take away my life, for I am not better than my fathers." Now, in response to his request, an angel came and gave him food to eat to strengthen him for his journey. Now, after 40 days, he arrived at Mount Horeb. Now, Horeb is called the mountain of God in Exodus 3 and verse 1. It's another name for Sinai. It was here that God made his covenant with his people. That's in Deuteronomy 5 and verse 2. You'll see it there. It was here also that the word of God had appeared to Moses in the burning bush. And it was here that God hid Moses in a cave while he passed by him in all his glory and proclaimed his name. The Lord God, merciful and gracious, long-suffering and abundant in goodness and truth, keeping mercy for thousands, forgiving iniquity and transgression and sin, and that will by no means clear the guilty. That's Exodus 34, verses 6 and 7. And it is here, this same place, Mount Horeb, that the word of the Lord now appears to Elijah. Let's have a read of it. It's in 1 Kings chapter 19 and verse 9. And it says here, "And he came thither unto a cave and lodged there. And behold, the word of the Lord came to him. And he said unto him, What doest thou here, Elijah?" It was a searching question addressed to one who had been called to an arduous and urgent mission. This was the beginning of the work of reformation, and Elijah had given up. To put this in some perspective, 3.5 years before, Elijah had prayed earnestly that it might not rain. Why? Well, to understand this, being an agricultural society, rain in Israel was essential for their survival. But the promise of rain was conditional. On what? Well, let's read it. We find it here in Deuteronomy chapter 11, verse 13 on to verse 17. Let's have a read here. Deuteronomy 13, Deuteronomy 11, verses 13 to 17. "And it shall come to pass," this was the promise of God that he made to the Israelites before they entered the promised land. So this is one of the statutes that he put there as a condition of remaining in that land. Let's have a read of it. "And it shall come to pass, if you shall hearken diligently unto my commandments, which I command you this day, to love the Lord your God and to serve him with all your heart and with all your soul, that I will give you the rain of your land in his due season." the first rain and the latter rain, that you may gather in your corn and your wine and your oil. And I will send grass in thy fields for thy cattle, that thou mayest eat and be full. So there you have it. God promised the rain if the children of Israel would serve him, would hearken diligently unto his commandments, which he commanded them that day. That's the words of the covenant. And that's the same thing God is saying to us as well. If we hearken diligently unto those commandments, then he will bless us with rain. That is all that we need for our physical needs. But that's a lesson for us too with the spiritual needs. And I want you to think about that, because I'm going to come back to that in the end of this study. Okay, so let's have a look now at the second part of this, because this is what I believe Elijah honed in on. Let's have a look here. Verse 16, take heed to yourselves that your heart be not deceived, and you turn aside and serve other gods and worship them. And then the Lord's wrath be kindled against you, and he shut up the heaven that there be no rain, and that the land yield not her fruit, and lest you perish quickly from off the good land which the Lord God giveth you. Now, at this time of Elijah, Israel was in a state of apostasy. Under Ahab and Jezebel, they had turned to the worship of Baal, the sun god. But Elijah had nothing to do with that. And he was nothing but a common man. But he was zealous for the glory of God. He understood that the only way for reformation was for Israel to be brought to repentance. So he rested firmly upon the word of God, and I believe it was upon this verse here in Deuteronomy, and prayed that it might not rain, and it didn't. Now, not much is said of Elijah's history or background. He just makes a very sudden appearance in Israel. Let's have a look here, 1 Kings 17, verse 10. And Elijah the Tishbite, who was of the inhabitants of Gilead, said unto Ahab, as the Lord God of Israel liveth, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years, but according to my word. Now, how could this relatively unknown person enter into the presence of the king in so an unusual a manner? He ventured, that is, Elijah ventured everything in the mission before him when he appeared before the king. So how was he able to do that? Well, Prophets and Kings says this, 121 to 122. It was only by the exercise of strong faith in the unfailing power of God's word that Elijah delivered his message. Had he not possessed implicit confidence in the one whom he served, he would never have appeared before Ahab. So there you have it. Elijah was a man of prayer, a man of faith, with implicit confidence in the God that he served. Prophets of Kings, page 119, goes on to say, far removed from any city of renown and occupying no high station in life, Elijah the Tishbite nevertheless entered upon his mission confident in God's purpose to prepare the way before him and to give him abundant success. The word of faith and power was upon his lips, and his whole life was devoted to the work of reform. His was the voice of one crying in the wilderness to rebuke sin and press back the tide of evil. And while he came to the people as a reprover of sin, his message offered the balm of Gilead to the sin-sick souls of all who desired to be healed. So what was then Elijah's message to Ahab? Notice this, there shall not be dew nor rain these years, but according to my word. Now, how could Elijah say that? Well, James 5:17 says he was a man subject to like passions as we are. But there was something here that he did. He prayed earnestly. He prayed earnestly that it might not rain, claiming the promise of God's word. And it rained not for the space of 3 years and 6 months. Now, how could he say such a thing at that time? I mean, what was Israel like before he prayed for it not to rain? Well, the Pen of Inspiration shares an insight on this. I want to share with you from Prophets and Kings, page 121, just on what the environment was like at the time. It says here, on his way to Samaria, Elijah had passed by ever-flowing streams, hills covered with verdure, and stately forests that seemed beyond the reach of drought. Everything on which the eye rested was clothed with beauty. The prophet might have wondered how the streams that had never ceased their flow could become dry, or how those hills and valleys could be burned with drought. But he gave no place to unbelief. He fully believed that God would humble apostate Israel and that through judgments they would be brought to repentance. And so he claimed God's promise and prayed that it would not rain until Israel was brought to repentance, irrespective of the outward signs to the contrary. Such was the faith of Elijah. This, brothers and sisters, beloved, is to be our experience today. We are to pray with the same type of faith as did Elijah. It was a faith in the Lord that enabled him to stand before King Ahab. Note how he introduced his message. He said here, "As the Lord God of Israel liveth, before whom I stand, there shall not be dew nor rain these years, but according to my word." The Lord God of Israel before whom I stand. No earthly monarch could intimidate Elijah, for he had bowed in faith. An implicit confidence in the King of the universe, in his power to save. Later, when Ahab accused him of bringing trouble upon Israel, Elijah fearlessly reproved Ahab. He said in verse 17 here, I'm reading from 1 Kings chapter 18, in verse 17 and 18, it says here, "And it came to pass when Ahab saw Elijah that Ahab said unto him, Art thou he that troubleth Israel? And he answered, I have not troubled Israel, but thou and thy father's house, in that ye have forsaken the commandments of the Lord and hast followed Balaam." But now we find Elijah running from his mission. He had been faithful and fearless, but God now finds him timid and doubtful, hiding in a cave. Just a few weeks before on Mount Carmel, God had sent fire from heaven in response to Elijah's prayer. He then sent a drought-breaking rain, again in response to Elijah's prayer. And then he strengthened Elijah to lead Ahab's chariot to Jezreel on foot in the driving rain. But in a moment of trial, when Jezebel threatened him, Elijah's faith failed. He fled from the post of duty. But the Lord understands the frailness of humanity, and now in his mercy, he comes to Horeb to encourage Elijah, revive his faith, and empower him to continue his mission. But Elijah first had to learn a lesson. What doest thou here, Elijah? In response, Elijah says in verse 10, I have been very jealous for the Lord God of hosts, for the children of Israel have forsaken thy covenant, thrown down thine altars, and slain thy prophets with the sword, and I, even I only, am left, and they seek my life to take it away. Now here we have Elijah somewhat in petulance, recounting all that he had done for God under his direction as if God didn't know what he had done. Elijah had carried it out faithfully, but now they want to kill him. The real problem in all of this is that Elijah didn't answer God's question. God had not told him to come here. If he had kept his trust in God, God would have directed him and protected him from Jezebel. That's a lesson for us. When we fail to keep our faith in God, we end up in places God would never have led us. Like Elijah, we need to learn the lesson of trust at all times and under all circumstances. Let me share here from the pen of inspiration. Not until Elijah had learned to trust wholly in God could he complete his work for those who had been seduced into Baal worship. The man of God must be made to understand the weakness of his present position as compared with the vantage ground the Lord would have him occupy. That's from Prophets and Kings, page 167. And so now God makes Elijah understand this point. Let's have a look here. In verse 11, I'm reading again from the scriptures, and he said, "Go forth and stand upon the mount before the Lord. And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and strong wind rent the mountains, and brake in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, a still small voice." 1 Kings 19:11 to 12. Now, this must have been an incredible experience for Elijah. The wind, the fire, the earthquake. But God was not in any of these, even though they were mighty manifestations of his divine power. Instead, God chose to reveal himself to his servant by a still, small voice. I think that says something about God and his work. Let me share with you from Prophets and Kings, page 168. God desired to teach Elijah that it is not always the work that makes the greatest demonstration that is most successful in accomplishing his purpose. You see, this display of divine power, while it's marvelous, it's not always a manifestation or a sign of success in God's work. But this had its effect on Elijah. Let's read further here. The servant of the Lord writes, "His petulance was silenced, his spirit softened and subdued. He now knew that a quiet trust, a firm reliance on God, would ever find for him a present help in time of need." That's Prophets and Kings, page 168. And that's what we need to learn too. It's not always the most learned presentation of God's truth that convicts and converts the soul. Not by eloquence or logic are men's hearts reached, but by the sweet influences of the Holy Spirit, which operate quietly yet surely in transforming and developing character. It is the still, small voice of the Spirit of God that has power to change the heart. Prophets and Kings, page 168. So Elijah continued on in his life's work. Having faithfully discharged it, he was taken to heaven without seeing death. Let's have a read. And it came to pass here in 2 Kings 2 verse 11. "And it came to pass as Elijah and Elisha still went on and talked that behold, there appeared a chariot of fire and horses of fire and parted them both asunder. And Elijah went up by a whirlwind into heaven." Isn't that marvelous? The very thing that he had feared at the hands of Jezebel, he never was to experience. He went to heaven without seeing death. And so it will be with the last generation. When God's work goes forth under the power of the latter rain, when we give the third angel's message of warning in power, we will be threatened with death. Prophecy tells us that. But we won't experience it. For the sake of God's glory, he will deliver us and then translate us at the second coming of Jesus without seeing death. Hence, the pen of inspiration explains this. Elijah, who had been translated to heaven without seeing death, represented those who will be living upon the earth at Christ's second coming and who will be changed in a moment in the twinkling of an eye at the last trump when this mortal must put on immortality, and this corruptible must put on incorruption. 1 Corinthians 15, verse 51 to 53. So won't that be a marvelous experience to be translated to heaven without seeing death? That's what happened to Elijah, and that is what God plans for his last generation. Now let's have a look at John the Baptist and see what we can learn from him. John the Baptist was a prophet raised to prepare the way for Christ's first coming. As we've learned this weekend, and God's people are a type, John the Baptist is a type of God's people. But let me share with you how John was introduced here in Luke. In Luke chapter 1 and verse 17, and in John's connection with Elijah. "And he shall go before the Lord in the spirit and power of Elias," which is Elijah, "to turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the just, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord." That's Luke chapter 1 verse 17. So just as John prepared the way for Christ's first advent, so we are to prepare people for Christ's second advent. So what can we learn then from John's experience to help us in preparing a people, particularly in our faith relationship with God, because it's by faith only that we stand, as we learned from Elijah. Well, let's look briefly at some aspects of John's life that set him apart in his generation. The first thing I want to look at is Matthew 3. Now, I may have been covering some ground that we've already looked at this last two nights or 2 days, but I trust Yeah, and this won't be too much for us to go through just very briefly some of these points here to help us to understand this aspect. What can we learn about the faith of John? Well, it says here in Matthew 3 and verse 1 and verse 4, I'm going to read here. In those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea. And verse 4 says, and the same John had his raiment of camel's hair and a leathern girdle about his loins, and his meat was locusts and wild honey. Now, John, there's a few things I want to bring out here. Number one, John's dress, his diet and his dress, and then his environment, that is where he grew up. Let's have a look firstly at his diet and dress. Now, you'll notice here that John's diet and dress was quite temperate. Temperance had a part in John's life. His diet was locusts and wild honey, and his diet was purely vegetable. Now, locust was not the grasshopper locust, but the locust was actually a plant that was grown in the Middle East. It's actually the locust bean. It's a tree that grows these pods. They're called locust beans, or it's called the carob tree. It's called locust bean tree there in that part of the Middle East, also called John the Baptist bread. So John was feasting upon locusts and wild honey. That's what he grew up on. This indicates to me that, you know, John's diet was very simple and plain, something that was a rebuke to the diet of his time. Not only was his diet a rebuke, but also his clothing. It says here that his clothing was a garment woven of camel's hair. Now, the servant of the Lord writes here that the simplicity of John's dress, a garment woven of camel's hair, was a standing rebuke to the extravagance and display of the Jewish priests and of the people generally, because they had rich garments woven with beautiful cloths and beautiful colors, and John was simply a garment woven with camel's hair. So this was a rebuke to the people of his time, so both his diet and his dress. So simply, it was just his way of living, his way of life was a rebuke. Now, my question is, why did John practice temperance? Okay, yes, to rebuke, but he could have rebuked people by his words, but why did he actually practice it in his life? Well, I want to share with you an insight on this from the pen of inspiration here, Desire of Ages, a beautiful book by Sister Ellen White. Desire of Ages, page 100. John was to go forth as Jehovah's messenger, to bring to men the light of God. He must give a new direction to their thoughts. He must impress them with the holiness of God's requirements and their need of his perfect righteousness. Such a messenger must be holy. He must be a temple for the indwelling Spirit of God. In order to fulfill his mission, he must have a sound physical constitution and mental and spiritual strength. Therefore, it would be necessary for him to control the appetites and passions. He must be able to control all his powers, that he could stand among men as unmoved by surrounding circumstances as the rocks and mountains of the wilderness. The servant of the Lord goes on to say here, in preparing the way for Christ's first advent, John was a representative of those who are to prepare a people for our Lord's second coming. The world is given to self-indulgence. Errors and fables abound. Satan's snares for destroying souls are multiplied. That's from the Desire of Ages, page 101. All who would perfect holiness, the servant of the Lord goes on to say here also, all who would perfect holiness in the fear of God must learn the lessons of temperance and self-control. The appetites and passions must be held in subjection to the higher powers of the mind. This self-discipline is essential to that mental strength and spiritual insight which will enable us to understand and practice the sacred truths of God's Word. So that's why temperance found a place in John's experience, and that's why temperance finds a place today in our experience. So to enable us to understand and to practice the sacred truths of God's Word. That's why temperance finds a place in the work for preparation, or the work of preparation for Christ's second coming. Desire of Ages 101. So hence the Apostle Paul wrote, now some people think, well, what's diet got to do with Christianity? Well, the Apostle Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 27, but I keep my body under and bring it into subjection, lest by any means when I have preached to others, I myself should be a castaway. So the Apostle Paul practiced temperance, and so should we, particularly as we are nearing Christ's second coming. There's going to be so much deception, so much false doctrine, so many winds of error everywhere, and it's happening all around us today. We need to have that clear discernment to be able to understand what is truth and to practice that truth and then to share that truth clearly in no uncertain terms with others. So that's why we are practicing temperance mainly. So the other thing I want to look at now with John's life is his home life. Where did John grow up? Well, let's have a look here in Luke chapter 1 verse 80. It says here that the child grew and waxed strong in spirit and was in the deserts till the day of his showing unto Israel. So John grew up in the wilderness, in a country living. It was country living for John. He didn't grow up in the cities. He grew up in the wilderness, in the nature, surrounded by nature. Let's have a look here. I'm going to share from the Pen of Inspiration again, Testimonies, Volume 4, page 109 on this and why John chose this. Because, I mean, sure, as a child growing up, you would live with your parents, but John obviously came to a point where he decided to remain there in the wilderness. I mean, he didn't have to. He could have left home and gone to the city, but he didn't. He remained in the wilderness. Why? Well, let's have a read here, Volume 4 of the Testimonies. It says here, he subjected himself to the privation and solitude in the wilderness, where he could preserve the sacred sense of the majesty of God by studying his great book of nature, and there becoming acquainted with his character as revealed in his wonderful works. It was an atmosphere calculated to perfect moral culture and to keep the fear of the Lord continually before him. So that's why John chose the wilderness. There he gained a better appreciation of God's character. The servant of the Lord goes on to write here, John, the forerunner of Christ, did not expose himself to evil conversation and the corrupting influences of the world. He feared, note this, he feared the effect upon his conscience that sin might not appear to him so exceedingly sinful. He chose rather to have his home in the wilderness where his senses would not be perverted by his surroundings. Should we not learn something from this? You know, from his example? I think we should, don't you? I mean, this is where we really need to be thinking about, where are we living today? You know, what are we surrounding our senses with? All the sights and sounds of the city, or maybe on our phones, on our computer screens? Or are we surrounding ourselves with the book of nature, with, you know, beholding God in nature and in the peace and beauty of nature and being free from the moral and contaminating influences of the world? You know, John the Baptist, even in doing all of this with his diet, his dress, his environment, he was not immune to temptation. Let's have a read here. I want to share with you from Bible Comments, Volume 5, page 1115. The servant of the Lord writes here, Satan had access to John even after he had closed every avenue in his power through which he would enter. But note this, it says here, his habits of life were so pure and natural that he could discern the foe and had strength of spirit and decision of character to resist him. So how about that? John's habits of life were so pure and natural that he could discern the foe and had strength of spirit and decision of character to resist him. So we may be faced with temptation, and so often we fall under it. Why is that? Maybe we can learn something here from John's experience, don't you think? Well, let me share with you now when John actually entered upon his mission. It says here in Volume 5 of Bible Comments, page 1119, this Pen of Inspiration says here, the people thought that John might be the promised Messiah. His life was so unselfish, marked with humility and self-denial. So there you have his dress, his diet, his environment where he grew up in, and even there when he was preaching his message in the wilderness, and they were looking at all of his habits of his life that were so unselfish, marked with humility and self-denial, they thought that John may have been the Messiah. In other words, they thought that he, was this the Christ? I mean, he was so Christ-like. And isn't that what God wants with us? I think it is. In these last days, God wants us to reflect this kind of character, Jesus' character in our lives. And how can we do that? Well, John leaves us some huge clues here. So let's think about that, huh? Jesus' commentary, I want to share with you now, in Matthew chapter 11, verse 7 to 9, Jesus' commentary assessment of John's mission. Let's have a look here. In verse 7, I'm reading, Jesus began to say unto the multitudes concerning John, "What went you out unto the wilderness to see? A reed shaken with the wind? But what went you out for to see? A man clothed in soft raiment? Behold, they that wear soft clothing are in kings' houses. But what went you out for to see? A prophet? Yea, I say unto you, and more than a prophet." You see, Jesus testified to John's faith. He was much more than a prophet. John's faith enabled him to stand fearless before leaders and kings. Why? Because I want to share this with you, a very beautiful passage here from Volume 8 of the Testimonies, page 331. It says here, John looked upon the King in his beauty, that is, the King of the universe, Jesus Christ. He looked upon him in his beauty and self was lost sight of. He beheld the majesty of holiness and knew himself to be inefficient and unworthy. It was God's message that he was to declare. It was in God's power and his righteousness that he was to stand. He was ready to go forth as heaven's messenger, unawed by the human, because he had looked upon the divine. He could stand fearless in the presence of earthly monarchs, because with trembling he had bowed before the King of Kings. So that's why John was able to stand fearless before earthly monarchs. Why? Because he had bowed before the King of the universe. And in bowing before him, humbled himself and in confidence went forth proclaiming his message. Now let's have a look now at the actual delivery of John's message. I'm going to share with you again from Volume 8 of the Testimonies. The servant of the Lord says it in better words than I can. She says here, "With no elaborate arguments or fine-spun theories did John declare his message. Startling and stern, yet full of hope, his voice was heard from the wilderness. Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Matthew 3 and verse 2. With a new strange power, it moved the people. The whole nation was stirred. John laid the axe to the root of the tree. He reproved sin, fearless of consequences, and prepared the way for the Lamb of God. John the Baptist came preaching the truth, and by his preaching, sinners were convicted and converted. That last statement was from Christ's Object Lessons, page 277. So by his preaching, sinners were convicted and converted. Why? Because he stood fearless, proclaiming God's message, laying the axe at the root of the tree. And that's what we need to do. And what's the root of the tree? The heart. Preach the message that reaches the hearts of the people, that points out their sin, that they might see their or realize their need for repentance and seek repentance and forgiveness with God, and thus find in him their salvation. I mean, that's the message that will convert. That's the attitude and the approach that we have to have, just like John did. John was able, as I mentioned before, was able to stand before kings. And I want to take you now to the experience that brought John to a crisis in his life. And that was when he gave his message to Herod. Let's have a read here in Mark chapter 6, verse 17 and 18. "For Herod himself had sent forth and laid hold upon John and bound him in prison for Herodias' sake." Now, Herodias was Herod's wife. Now, it says that his brother Philip's wife, for he had married her. "For John had said unto Herod, it is not lawful for thee to have thy brother's wife." So John rebuked the king here even. It was this rebuke that unfortunately found him in prison. And there in the depths of Herod's dungeons, John had time to reflect on his mission. He believed Jesus was the Messiah, but he didn't expect to end up in prison for his faith. Wasn't Christ meant to deliver the captives from the prison house and set at liberty them that are bound and establish his kingdom there and then? So how could this person then be the promised Messiah if John is here in prison? I mean, I can imagine what John must have been thinking, all the doubts he might have been tempted to think. You know, at some point, doubts even arose to John expressing it. He was distressed and depressed, just like Elijah, and he began even to question his mission. Let's read it in Luke chapter 7, verse 18 to 23. It says here, "And the disciples of John showed him of all these things. And John, calling unto him two of his disciples, sent them unto Jesus, saying, Art thou he that should come, or look we for another? Now when the men were come unto him, unto Jesus, that is, they said, John the Baptist hath sent us unto thee, saying, Art thou he that should come, or look we for another? Now, note how Jesus answered them. Well, really, he didn't answer them. He just showed them his life. Look what he said in verse 21. And in that same hour, he cured many of their infirmities and plagues and of evil spirits, and unto many that were blind, he gave sight. Then Jesus answering said unto them, Go your way and tell John what things you have seen and heard, how that the blind see, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised, to the poor the gospel is preached. So basically, Jesus was saying, look, everything that Isaiah had prophesied of the Messiah, what he would do, that's what I'm doing right now. So be of good courage, John. And Jesus said these words to John in this particular slight rebuke to John in verse 23, Luke 7 verse 23. And blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended because of me. Now the servant of the Lord goes on to say here in the Zohar of Ages, page 217, the works of Christ not only declared him to be the Messiah, but showed in what manner his kingdom was to be established. To John was opened the same truth that had come to Elijah in the desert. Jesus was to do his work not with the clash of arms and the overturning of thrones and kingdoms, but through speaking to the hearts of men by a life of mercy and self-sacrifice. No doubt John heard their report and rested in the assurance it brought him. He had been faithful in giving his message, regardless of the consequences, and now, in prison for his faith, he would not be offended. I think there's a lesson there for us today. And not just a lesson there, but there's a few lessons. I want to go over a few of them. Firstly, the firmness of John to principle. Was he a reed shaken in the wind? No. To the self-righteous Pharisees, the priestly Sadducees, King Herod and his court, princes and soldiers, publicans and peasants, John had spoken with equal plainness. He was no trembling reed, swayed by the winds of human praise or prejudice. In the prison, he was the same in his loyalty to God and his zeal for righteousness as when he preached God's message in the wilderness. In his faithfulness to principle, he was firm as a rock. Now, that's a lesson for us. Now, the second point I want to bring out here, or lesson I think we can learn, is not only John's firmness to principle, but his humility. Jesus said of John, "There hath not risen a greater than John the Baptist." And John said of Jesus, "He must increase, but I must decrease." You know, the servant of the Lord writes on this, in the Zohar of Ages, page 219, it is the moral worth that God values. Love and purity are the attributes he prizes most. John was great in the sight of the Lord when, before the messengers from the Sanhedrin, before the people and before his own disciples, he refrained from seeking honor for himself, but pointed all to Jesus as the promised one. His unselfish joy in the ministry of Christ presents the highest type of nobility ever revealed in man. Now, just in case we may get the wrong idea on what it means to be a reformer like John and Elijah, let me share again from the pen of inspiration. And here it puts the two lessons together. The humility of John and his meekness and his firmness to principle. Let's have a read here. This is from the servant of the Lord writing here in Testimonies, Volume 6, page 151. And she writes here, "Reformers are not destroyers. They will never seek to ruin those who do not harmonize with their plans and assimilate to them. Reformers must advance, not retreat. They must be decided, firm, resolute, unflinching. But firmness must not degenerate into a domineering spirit. God desires to have all who serve him firm as a rock where principle is concerned, but meek and lowly of heart as was Christ. Then, abiding in Christ, they can do the work he would do were he in their place. A rude, condemnatory spirit is not essential to the heroism in the reforms of this time. All selfish methods in the service of God are an abomination in his sight." So that's what God wants us to be, a true reformer, where we are firm as a rock to principle, but meek and lowly of heart, as was Jesus. That's what John was. That's what Elijah learned to be. And that's what you and I need to be too. Now, there's one more lesson I want to share with you before we close. And this is the lesson of Elijah's prayer for rain, because it says here that he prayed not only that it would not rain, but that it would rain. And I know you and I are expecting the latter rain to fall, that is the power of the Holy Spirit to fall upon us to help us and enable us to finish God's work. Now, we need that rain, that spiritual rain. But let's see what we can learn from this physical rain that Elijah prayed for to see what we can see how we should apply this to our own experience today in praying for the latter rain. So let's have a look at the experience. Firstly, it's here in 1 Kings chapter 18, 41 to 44. We'll read this here. Elijah said to Ahab, "Get thee up." So this was after Elijah had prayed. He said, "Get thee up, eat and drink." No, sorry, not after he had prayed. It was before he prayed. "Get thee up, eat and drink, for there is a sound of abundance of rain." Now, there was not a cloud in the sky, but Elijah had faith in God's promise. You see, the children of Israel, this was on the top of Mount Carmel. The children of Israel had just been returned back to the worship of God. Elijah had slain the prophets, and now having the people turn back to God's worship, Elijah believed God would now fulfill the promise to send rain again. And so he says to Ahab, well, it says here in verse 42, "Ahab went up to eat and drink, and Elijah went up to the top of Carmel, and he cast himself down upon the earth and put his face between his knees." Now, it was not because of any outward evidence that the showers were about to fall that Elijah could so confidently bid Ahab prepare for the rain. The prophet saw no clouds in the heavens. He heard no thunder. He simply spoke the word that the Spirit of the Lord had moved him to speak in response to his own strong faith. So it wasn't just a passive instrument. Elijah had a strong faith in God's word that he would perform his word, that he would fulfill it, that he would send the rain, and the Spirit then moved him to speak what he believed. And he spoke what he believed, that God's going to send rain. Throughout the day, he had unflinchingly performed the will of God and had revealed his implicit confidence in the prophecies of God's word. And now, having done all that was in his power to do, so let me just repeat that, implicit confidence in the prophecies of God's word. I want you to think about that. And now, having done all that was in his power to do, he knew that heaven would freely bestow the blessings foretold. So, now with this faith in God's word, in the prophecies of God's word, Elijah prays. Ahab goes up to eat, and Elijah goes to the top of Mount Carmel and casts himself upon the earth with his face between his knees. He said to his servant, "Go up now, look toward the sea." And he went up and looked and said, "There is nothing." And he said, "Go again." Seven times he said that. Again. Now let me share from the servant of the Lord here. She writes this. "Again and again, Elijah sent his servant to a point overlooking the Mediterranean to learn whether there were any visible tokens, that God had heard his prayer. Each time the servant returned with the word, 'There is nothing.' The prophet, however, did not become impatient or lose faith, but continued his earnest pleading. That's Prophets and Kings, page 156. Now let's read verse 4, what happens. And it came to pass, verse 44, I should say, or what happens. And it came to pass at the seventh time that he said, "Behold, there ariseth a little cloud out of the sea, like a man's hand." And he said, "Go up, say unto Ahab, prepare thy chariot and get thee down, that the rain stop thee not." Now Elijah did not wait. It says here in Prophets and Kings 1:56, Elijah did not wait for the heavens to gather blackness. In that small cloud, he beheld by faith an abundance of rain. And he acted in harmony with his faith, sending his servant quickly to Ahab with the message, "Prepare thy chariot and get thee down, that the rain stop thee not." Now, what's the lesson for us? Well, firstly, what was the context of this man of prayer? What was the context of this man of prayer? Come back with me to James chapter 5, but I want to look at verses 16 and verse 20, which is just before and just after James recounts Elijah's prayer for the rain to not to stop and the rain to come again. It says here in verse 16, "Confess your faults one to another and pray for one another that ye may be healed. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man availeth much." Now that's the context of this incident about Elijah. And James goes on to say here, "Brethren," in verse 20, "if any of you do err from the truth and one convert him, let him know that he which converteth the sinner from the error of his way shall save a soul from death and shall hide a multitude of sins." So this is the context. The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man. And James concludes on the words that is the work of saving souls, working for those who err from the truth, that our prayers and efforts are the avail of righteousness. So that brings me then to this point, that to have such an answer to prayer as Elijah did, we need to be righteous people. But how can I be a righteous person? The Bible says there's none righteous. Well, we need to be justified. We need to be made righteous. Now, what is justification by faith? What is it? Well, you're probably familiar with this statement, but I'll share it again because I think it's very appropriate here. The Faith I Live By, page 111. The servant of the Lord writes here, "What is justification by faith? It is the work of God in laying the glory of man in the dust and doing for man that which is not in his power to do for himself. When men see their own nothingness, they are prepared to be clothed with the righteousness of Christ." So that's what it is, laying our glory in the dust of the earth. And that's what Elijah was doing up there on Carmel. "Those whom heaven recognizes," it goes on to say here, "as holy ones are the last to parade their own goodness. The apostle Peter became a faithful minister of Christ, and he was greatly honored with divine light and power. He had an active part in the upbuilding of Christ's church, but Peter found in himself nothing in which to glory." Now, this is the attitude of a righteous person. Now, I want to ask, did God answer the prayer of Elijah straight away? I mean, there on Mount Carmel, just previously, Elijah had prayed for fire to come down from heaven and it came down immediately. What about the rain? Why didn't the rain come down straight away? Well, let's have a look. In James 5 verse 5, it says here that the effectual prayer of God answers this question with these words, "The effectual fervent prayer of a righteous man avails much." That's the point here. Elijah had to be righteous in God's sight. Elijah himself had to come to the point where his glory was laid in the dust of the earth. Let me share from two Bible comments, page 1034 and 1035 on this. It says here, "Had Elijah given up in discouragement at the sixth time, his prayer would not have been answered, but he persevered till the answer came. We have a God whose ear is not closed to our petitions, and if we prove his word, he will honor our faith. He wants us to have all our interests interwoven with his interests. And then he can safely bless us, for we shall not then take glory to self when the blessing is ours, but shall render to God all the praise. So this is why God's delayed the outpouring of his Spirit. The reason is that if he pours that upon us when we're not surrendered to him, when we have self, when we're still, you know, not wrapping up all of our interests, or interweaving all of our interests with his interests. That is, you know, we're sort of half-hearted in our service for God, in doing missionary work and in sharing the gospel and simply just living a Christian life. We're too caught up with the cares of this life. And so, you know, God can't bless us. It's why it's not safe for him to do so. And that's why we're not receiving the latter rain. Let's read here. Few receive the grace of Christ with self-abasement, with a deep and permanent sense of their unworthiness. They cannot bear the manifestations of the power of God, for this would encourage in them self-esteem, pride, and envy. This is why the Lord can do so little for us now. That's Volume 5 of the Testimonies, page 50. So, what's the lesson here for us? Well, this is the lesson for me. God answers prayer based on our humility. That is, it depends on how humble we are, whether God's going to really answer us as we want him to. You know, Elijah, we read here in Bible Comments, Volume 2, page 1035, Elijah humbled himself until he was in a condition where he would not take the glory to himself. This is the condition upon which the Lord hears prayer, for then we shall give the praise to him. That's what we need to be in, that condition where we will not take the glory to ourselves for anything the Lord does for us, particularly when it comes to miracle-working power of the Holy Spirit. Again, let me just come back now to this last point here in regard to Elijah's heart search. You know, he was up there searching his heart, and as he was doing that, it says here that he seemed to be less and less, both in his own estimation and in the sight of God. It seemed to him that he was nothing and God was everything. And when he reached the point of renouncing self while clinging to the Savior as his only strength and righteousness, guess what? The answer came. That's when God sent that small cloud there in the heavens. Isn't that beautiful? It was when Elijah reached that point of renouncing totally himself while he clung to Jesus as his only strength and righteousness. That's the condition we must be in if the Lord is to answer our prayer for the latter rain. So in closing, I want to share just a reflection on our mission today. You know, when God asked Elijah, "What doest thou here?" Elijah had lost faith in God and left his post of duty. He needed to learn the lesson of complete trust in God in order to continue his mission. In contrast, John the Baptist had remained faithful to his duty until he ended up in prison. But even then, in a moment of self-doubt, he asked himself, perhaps, what am I doing here? He too needed to learn the lesson of complete trust and confidence in God in order to remain faithful unto death, and he did. So, how is it with you? Have you given up in despair or fearfulness of what might happen to you if you stand up for your convictions like Elijah did, or like John, have you questioned why things have turned out so bad in your experience when all you've done is shared God's word and faithfulness? Well, I just want to say to you that don't despair and don't doubt. God is still here waiting and watching for us to learn the lessons of faith, courage, and humility that enabled Elijah and John to accomplish their mission and be successful in it. So let's learn these lessons and get up and go and finish the work God has given us to do. This is my wish and my prayer for us this morning. Amen. Let's pray. Dear Father in heaven, we come before you now to thank you for the opportunity that we've had to hear this message, to reflect upon these two great prophets that you raised up, Elijah and John the Baptist. Father, we know that they were men of like passions as we are, and at times their faith wavered, they made their mistakes, Lord. But you revived them, you strengthened them to press on in their mission, and they were faithful in that, and you rewarded them, Lord. You have reserved for John a crown of life because he was faithful unto death, and you translated Elijah to heaven without seeing death. And I know that's the promise you have for us today, to translate us to heaven without seeing death. We know that there is a crisis before us, Lord. And right now we're going through such difficult times, unprecedented times, Lord, in our lives. But we just pray, Lord, for you to strengthen us, to revive us, to keep us and our faith fixed on you, on Jesus, and to look up, that we can receive the latter rain. We know for that to happen, we must surrender ourselves. So I pray that we will do that today, that our hearts will be surrendered fully to you, that self will be lost sight of as we behold the King Jesus in all his beauty, and our self will be lost sight of. So may this be the experience of each one of us, I pray, and we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
A remarkable message. It is a message of hope. Notwithstanding our human frailties and weaknesses, God is always there for us. And in the most difficult moments in our lives, if we take hold of His mighty hand, He will be there for us to help us. We live in uncertain times. We have seen dramatic, unprecedented changes in the course of this year. And who knows the future? No one. We know something, but God knows everything. Today we need the faith of Elijah, faith of John the Baptist. Keep the faith, brethren. Have a relationship with God. Know Him through His Word. Know Him through His Son, Jesus Christ. And you will be safe, and He will help you to go through. As we come to the end of this conference, I'd like to give some credits and express appreciation on behalf of our conference to those who have helped us organize and execute this wonderful conference. First of all, I'd like to thank our guest speakers, Brother Nathan Tyler for his Friday presentation, our brother minister from Australia. We thank him for the first time being our guest speaker in Canada. We also thank Brother Eli Tenorio, the General Conference President, our dear brother who has spent many years with us here in Canada and who we always like to hear and to see for his contribution. We thank Brother Peter Lausewick, who is the General Conference Representative for North America, the Regional Secretary, for his message. And we also thank Brother Paul Chapman for the last presentation, brother from Australia, who is also the first time a guest speaker at our conference. Thank you all, brethren. We also wish to express gratitude and thanks to the gospel workers in the East Canadian Field Conference who have together with me prepared this event, selecting the theme, selecting the topics, and also for introducing the speakers. Special thanks goes to the musicians. Musicians made a difference at this conference because we cannot sing. Music really helped us, especially instrumental music, and we wish to give thanks to the Canadian Conference, East Canadian Conference Music Coordinator, Sister Vera Schioppu, and also to Sister Bianca Sirbu, who has, as a young person, done an amazing work here in Toronto with young musicians, and especially wish to mention that these young musicians have worked tirelessly and selflessly together with Sister Bianca here, and training and practicing and recording wonderful music, and I trust that you all have been blessed by this music. Regarding the recording, I'd like to mention Brother Etienne Lombard, who has done a lot of work preparing sermons, editing, and working with recordings. And also here locally in Toronto, we thank Sister Bianca Sirbu and Sister Marta Sirbu and Sister Caitlin Hanushka. These three young ladies have worked diligently preparing, recording the music, editing, and preparing for this event. We also wish to thank media departments of our local churches who have done great work putting together this program for online broadcast. And we thank you all, brethren, viewers, and those who have been in person present in our meetings for attending the programs and for praying for us. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord help you in your lives as we go on throughout this year and in the future. I would like to end this program with a blessing that is recorded in 2 Corinthians 13, 14. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Ghost be with you all. Amen.